symmetric assort and unifies gauge couplings, gives neutron masses by type 1, seesaw, radix, Higgs-ino, neutralino, we know as dark matter. Radix are parity as gauge discrete symmetry for the stability of dark matter, baryogenesis via leptogenesis, and explains the origin of parity violation in weak interaction in the way of high-scale parity restoration. It has natural solutions to the gauge. Supersymmetry appears to be indispensable for fundamental understanding of particle physics, as we have learned from John Stock. But we should also think outside the super box. In one of his talks, there is a line like this. So in the absence of any experimental confirmation of supersymmetry so far, and with the fine-tuning approach to gauge hierarchy problem, we attempt to see if similar solutions exist in non-supersymmetric certain for neutron masses, dark matter, baryon asymmetry, and unification of gauge couplings within standard model paradigm. That means I do not assume any gauge version beyond the standard model gauge version, below the God scale. For fine tuning, see this reference. Consider certain going to SU5 cross U1X going to the standard model. Although this appears to be two-step breaking, for practical purposes, we'll make these first two scales identical. But after second step breaking, let us say, the U1 quantum number X is equal to 4 T3R plus 3B minus L. T3R is the third component of isotropic spin, whether when you use a doublet or a triplet to break the X symmetry. And 45H breaks the GOT groups. So we see that there are two ways we can come to the standard model, 45H plus 16H, 45H. The 16H contains a doublet which has T3R is equal to half, and 126H contains the popularly known right-handed triplet which has T3R plus 1, minus 1. So ZX defined as minus 1 raised to power 4 T3R plus 3B minus L is identical equal to minus 3B minus L in both cases, because 4 T3R for the doublet is equal to 2. So this is power raised to power 2. In this case, it is 4. That is power raised to power 4. So this is minus 3B minus L. This is defined as matter parity. And in this case, when there is a doublet, it has B minus L is equal to minus 1. So when we put B minus L minus 1, matter parity becomes discrete. Value is minus 1. Therefore, this has broken spontaneously when we follow this method. And in the second method, this is because B minus L is equal to minus 2, ZMP is equal to plus 1, and therefore, standard model Lagrangian conserves matter parity as gauge discrete symmetry. So this becomes the stabilizing symmetry of the standard model predicted by non-supersymmetric SOT. It's analogous to R parity in supersymmetry. Standard model fermions, therefore, since they have B minus L is equal to plus 1, so therefore, standard model fermions have matter parity is equal to minus 1, and standard model Higgs boson has matter parity plus 1 because it has B minus L 0. And not only that, this matter parity, when we come through the 126H mediated breaking, the matter parity of all SO10 representations are well defined. For example, 10, 45, 54, 120, 120C2, 10, etc. have even matter parity. And these binarial representations like 16, 144, they have odd matter parity. So no wonder that standard model fermions are contained here in 16 and standard model, this color is contained in 10 of us. So therefore, this gives a line of action if you want to choose the candidates of dark matter. If you want to choose dark matter as a fermionic dark matter, then choose the opposite matter parity compared to the standard model fermions. So standard model fermions are in 16 matter parity minus. So dark matter fermions should be any one of these representations. And if you want to use scalar as a dark matter, choose the multiplied with opposite parity. So the standard scalar is here with opposite matter parity plus. So choose this binarial scalar from 16 or 144 as the dark matter. So I have given the references where this type of approach has been followed, and there are more papers also. Then the certain invariant Lagrangian, Uka Lagrangian, which is given here, both of them are matter parity conserving term. You remember that Gell-Mann, Ramanujan and Slansky used in 1978 this Lagrangian, and they arrived at type 1 system. I think if they would have asked the question of matter parity, then they would have predicted the dark matter stability, and type 1, type 2 seesaw would have followed automatically. Because once you have got this OCA interaction, then there is a hybrid seesaw for neutron masses. This is type 2 seesaw and type 1 seesaw. In other words, we can say 126H breaking through 126H dagger is inevitable if you want dark matter to be originating from a certain representation. So once we have 126H dagger, then dark matter predicts type 1, type 2 seesaw mechanism. That means the formula for neutronal masses. Here MD is the Dirac neutron mass. This one is type 2 seesaw term. This is type 1 seesaw term. MD is equal to the Dirac neutron mass, which is almost equal to the up quark mass by virtue of the underlying quark lepton symmetry in SOT. And this is the induced vacuum expectation value of the left-handed triplet, which is also there in 126H. And VR will be, because it is one step breaking effectively, VR will be of the order of the God scale. And this M delta is left-handed triplet mass. And lambda is the associated quartic coupling in the Higgs potential. And MN is called F times VR, F times M God. So if we look into equation 3, we find MD we know, VL we know. If we fix M delta, we fix M delta at 10 to power 12 GP. And for a given lambda, all other parameters are known. And we treat F as an unknown. Left-hand side, M nu is known. So while applying this hybrid system formula to the left-right symmetric model, it was noted by Akhmedov and company in 2007 that for every mass eigenvalue, there are two solutions because it is quadratic. And then for three mass eigenvalues, we will have 2 to the power 3, and there are 8 values of F. So to arrive at these solutions for F, you have used basis dependent determination of the Dirac neutron mass matrix. For that purpose, we extrapolate all the charged fermion masses from electroweak scale using the renormalization group equation to the God scale. And at the God scale, we equate the Dirac neutron mass with the up quark neutron mass matrix. So this we do assuming first the D quark diagonal basis, down quark diagonal basis, one case, and another up quark diagonal basis. So this is one example of solutions when we use D quark diagonal basis. This is the Dirac Newton mass matrix determined using D quark diagonal basis. Similarly, This is in the assuming of quark diagonals. So you have two different types of Dirac-Newton mass matrix. So we should have 8 solutions in this case and 8 solutions in that case. So, but we find that there are, for example, with we have presented here the F, one equation, second equation, third equation, fourth equation. So there are 4 values we have reported. And we have found that out of these values of F, the two, there are 2 types of distinct solutions. What is their role? How do we know they are distinct? We multiply this F by VR. Then once we multiply F by VR, we have right-handed neutrino mass matrix. We diagonalize them. And after diagonalization, we find that there are 2 distinct type of solutions coming from this quadratic. So this is the hierarchical spectrum of right-handed. One type of solutions are hierarchical, and the right-handed neutrino masses vary from 10 to the power 5 to 10 to the power 12. So over 8 to 9 orders of, over 7 to 8 orders. And there is another kind of, so this is different values of lambda. Another kind of solution, we find that the masses vary only over 3 orders of magnitude, only over 2 to 3 orders of magnitude. So the former solution we call hierarchical solution, and this solution, which is not so hierarchical, we got called a compact spectrum. Hierarchical spectrum and compact. Then we compute the CP asymmetry using the standard method. But in this case, there is an additional diagram, loop diagram, mediated by the left-handed triplet. There will be contributions due to direct decay of left-handed triplet. But we find that those are negligible compared to these contributions. So using the contribution of these 3 diagrams, we compute CP asymmetry and then compute the variant asymmetry using Boltzmann equations. We do a complete favor analysis. So our results for the compact spectrum in the U diagonal basis are given in this figure. Lambda is equal to 0.05. Here, this y-axis is variant asymmetry. This is Z, and this is Z, the lightest neutron decaying, and then we have various flavors we have studied, and then variant asymmetry in E plus mu flavor is given by double dot dashed line. So this line is for E plus mu, and top flavor is by dot dashed line. So we find that dot dashed line has a better agreement with Planck 2015 data. Then we do it same thing with hierarchical spectrum of right-handed neutron masses. So we find that here that the separate different flavor contributions are given separately here. Here they are combined E plus mu here and tau here. So E plus mu is showing a better agreement with Planck 2015. So in both cases, the basis which makes this agreement is of quark diagonal basis. So to summarize, using solutions from Boltzmann equation, we get baryon asymmetry in agreement with Planck 2015 data. This occurs in the case of Dirac neutron masses derived using of quark diagonal basis. The agreement occurs with both compact and hierarchical spectra of right-handed neutron masses. We have used normally ordered light masses. A triplet, then we look into the embedding of dark matter, the actual candidate. The stability has been described, the matter parity. triplet Majorana fermion dark matter proposed in this standard model extension in 2005, and this is this SU2 left triplet fermion, SU2 left quantum number, y is equal to 0, SU3 color singlet. This is contained in 45F of this model. 45F contains three fermion singlets. We can also behave as dark matter in addition to sigma 301. It also contains, if we take 45F as a non-standard fermion multiplet, then it has also color octet fermions. So mass difference computed by Cirelli and the company is on sigma plus minus minus sigma zero. Mass is 166 mu. Extensive investigation on direct signals and proposed collider searches has been carried out by a large number of authors in this model. That's why we have chosen this candidate as a possible search for embedding this as a possible candidate. So suggested mass rate from indirect searches are 400 to 2700 GeV. Substantially affects SU2 left gauge coupling evolution because it is a triplet under SU2 left. And direct search constraints are from LOX, Xenon 100, greater than 35 GeV, LSC, as you have learned from Dr. Bose yesterday, it will be 1 to 1000 GeV. So what about the mass? How we can get the mass of the triplet fermion dark matter? It is said that dark matter doesn't have interaction. That's a popular belief. That is true so far as standard Higgs is concerned. Dark matter should not have UCA interaction with the standard Higgs. But this matter parity invariance predicts this Lagrange. F is 45F, and this MA is the bear master, which is a certain invariant, and this HP is the UCA coupling of the 210 Higgs representation. EHE is the UCA coupling of the 54 Higgs representation. This is 210, this is 54 Higgs scalars. So this is a certain invariant and matter parity invariant. All those Higgs scalars which mediate this non-standard UCA interaction are at the God scale. So they'll never appear at the electron scale. So stability of dark matter is not affected by these high mass Higgs scalars. So the triplet Majorana fermion mass can have any value between 100 to 115 GeV theoretically, and only experiments can reject it or accept. Similarly, all multiplets in 45F, that is singlets, color octet fermions, can have lower mass values. For example, using a vacuum expectation value in the 1110 direction in the left-right symmetry language, or 111 direction in the Patisalam language, so this is that vacuum expectation value which is at the God scale. Similarly, this is the vacuum expectation value at the God scale. By just tuning these vacuum expectation value and the parameters, you can have triplet fermion mass anywhere between 100 to 100 GeV to 10 to the power 15 GeV. Similarly, if you want a color octet fermion mass, then it can be also done. We use the fields, so now we look into, after having obtained the triplet fermion dark matter mass, we look into the unification of gauge coupling. So the idea has been to populate the grand desert by ingredients, by fields needed for hybridisis, leptogenesis, and dark matter. So these three phenomena have guided us to locate the non-standard fields beyond the standard model. We know that the standard model gauge couplings do not unify, and a triangle appears between 10 to the power 11 GeV to 10 to the power 17 GeV. And only if there are additional fields in the Grand Desert, it is possible to reduce this triangle to a point. So that is the approach. So our additional fields are given by delta L. Our additional fields are given by delta L, sigma needed for neutron mass, leptogenesis, and dark matter. In addition, we need a color octet fermion, C8108, which is also contained in 45A. Its mass is derived in the same way. And the significance of this has been recently pointed out that this can be used as a non-thermal source of triplet fermion dark matter. So we use the standard renormalization group equations, and in addition, so this is, in this there are one loop contributions for different particles, and these are two loop terms, and this is threshold contribution. So we find that if you ignore the threshold corrections, we have got a beautiful unification at 10 to the power 15.56 GeV. And what are the masses? The input masses are given here. This triplet fermion dark matter is at 500 GeV, and that color octet fermion has 10 to the power 7.7 GeV, and our scalar triplet mass mediating type 2 seesaw and leptogenesis is at 10 to the power 12 GeV. With these additional particles, we achieve these units. Otherwise, if we remove these three, it reduces to non-unified standard model gauge couplings or all single step breaking gods without any additional field in the Grand Desert. So here the Grand Desert has been populated by these fields, and therefore we get unification. Reference for threshold effects. So once we have dark matter multiplets in the Grand Desert, they will contribute to substantially to threshold effect in addition to this one. Why? Because dark matter is obtained from a fermion, and one of the multiplet has been pulled down. So therefore, even if we take all these supernova masses degenerate, they will contribute to threshold. And 126H, which is a big multiplet, but its presence is inevitable because of dark matter stability. So many people who did ascertain, they rejected 126H on the ground that it's a very big representation and it will contribute to large uncertainty. But dark matter motivates strongly in favor of 126. So these are our threshold effect due to various representation, due to 10, 45, 126, and then we also add that due to the dark matter fermions. But at present, super Kamiokande limit is experimental limit for proton lifetime p going to e plus pi naught is equal to 1.4 into 10 to the power 34 years. But as you know, the super Kamiokande will and hyper Kamiokande will explore the up to 2 into 10 to the power 35 years. So our prediction here, including threshold effects, are 1.8 into 10 to the power 34 years if we ignore all threshold effects, slightly greater than the current limit. 1.4 has been sent to 1.8, slightly bigger. But once you include threshold effects, which are inevitable because you have bigger representations and fermions, and even if that is eta s is equal to log 10 of ms divided by mu. Ms is the super heavy scalar mass. Similarly, this is for fermions. Mf is the super heavy fermion mass. If there is a departure of few times from the God scale, that means if they are heavier or lighter by few times than the God scale, then there is substantial contribution to the proton lifetime. So this was unavailable in the other models. With dark matter, we see the enhancement in the proton light. This is major part is due to 126. So this is the prediction of proton lifetime. The green shaded line is already ruled out by Kamiokande limit, and we have these different. This is if we take only fermion contributions, the threshold effect, if we take scalar 126, N 45, H contributions, and then if fermion and scalar work oppositely, you have this line. If they work in the same direction, then this line will be much higher. So this is our proton lifetime prediction. So therefore, to summarize, non-supersymmetric SO10 directly breaking to standard model can successfully answer the questions of neutron mass, baryon asymmetry, dark matter stability to gauge discrete spectrum, unification of gauge coupling, and observed proton stability. It gives asymptotic parity restoration and explains the origin of parity violation in weak interaction. Embedding dark matter in SO10 enhances proton lifetime prediction substantially. Resolution of gauge hierarchy problem by fine tuning is not as natural as in supersymmetric SO10, but non-SUSY SO10 also has few advantages. In non-supersymmetric SO10, there is no gravitational problem. Of course, you modify the supersymmetric model to accommodate the gravitational problem. Or there is no problem associated with Higgs-mediated proton decay as in the supersymmetric gods. Doublet, triplet splitting, to do it in supersymmetric model, you have to do additional effort, use additional bigger multiplets. But in this case, it occurs naturally because you use something called extended survival bar hypothesis. Only those Higgs scalars are light, which are needed to be light because of spontaneous breaking region. Others become super heavy at the next gauge symmetry.